I can hear you. God, you got low on the wiki here.
You got everything muted.
Yo, what's happening, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of Strange Happenings. As always, we're bringing the strange. I'm your host, Mikey. As always, the bro host, Bub.
Hello.
And behind the scenes at Master Control, Stoner and Dizbro, the bro. Stoner, the all-encompassing wizard. Mm-hmm. And we appreciate everything those guys do. Make everything look and sound awesome. Looks like we got some folks in the chat hanging out. Born Not to Run. What's
Happy
happening?
Monday.
Cryptids of the Corn. I'm guessing that's Mr. E at work listening, or Jay.
Yeah.
One of those guys, which brings up the awesome rad time we had at Frogman Fest.
Got the shirt
this
on.
Weekend. We had a Friday night hang with the fellas. We had a good time.
It was a weekend.
Did some AV work. Help Jeff and John out a little bit in the speaker room and trying to our best to make everything look good and sound good in there.
I thought it went out pretty well.
Yeah, it was really cool to just meet all the speakers and exchange contacts and be able to kind of expand the bro zone.
Well, and ease up their day a little bit. I think you or Kyle had said that, you know, they'd never had so many people come back and say, oh gosh, that was so great. That made it so easy. You know,
right.
Whatever it was about it, that was
Necro, what's happening, dude?
Just facilitating the day was a lot of fun to be able to help out with. This picture's great.
And this is our hang on Friday after setup. We got there around like 9 o'clock. This is at the Monkey Bar in Mainesville, or one of those little Miami River Valley area is just so cool.
I know, right?
And this place was right on the river, and it poured that whole drive down there, and that river was full.
I want to go there when it's warm.
Yeah.
I want to be out
on
that.
The deck, on the patio. Yeah. Such a sweet spot.
Maybe in the spring sometime.
You know, these folks were great people. We got to meet all these guys. Were awesome. Some Cryptids of the Corn fans had a nice little meetup and group, and we crashed the party. And, It was a super fun thing. Oh, yeah.
Jay in his double hat. He goes the next day. He's like, I didn't even know I was wearing a double hat. Because until I saw that picture, I was like, oh, yeah, you were doing it.
Oh, great.
And I want a hat from Mark. I want him to make me a hat. The guy with the hat on backwards was making a lot of sweet caps for Cryptids of the Corn.
Right. But the presentation room was fun.
Oh yeah.
A lot of people had come up to our table, were hanging out with us, saying what's up. We got to meet, and this is a photo of James Willis. He's the Strange and Spooky as his brand. And
but he did all like the Weird Ohio, the Weird US books.
Yeah, he's an author.
Yeah.
Goes around, gives great presentations. This was on Loveland Frogman folklore in general, of kind of how you get from this sighting to basically a frogman in the river with a wand, and how it kind of became what we now know as the Loveland Frogman. It was really, really cool stuff.
He gave every aspect of it from the outside reports, right? And just the variations on the size and color and shape and how many there were, if they had weird, like, bulbous bellies and these weird, like,
through the whole
astrological or zodiac symbols on their stomachs, all, like, weird stuff. That part threw me off.
I'd never heard anybody talk so in-depth on, really, it was more like the historical angle, not necessarily from the encounters, but chronologically kind of putting the whole timeline together.
Yeah.
And the variations, like you said, of...
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, from the outset of, we saw this, stories. We saw that. Mm-hmm. You know, no, somebody shot a lizard, or they didn't shoot it, or they brought it here. It was like this. Because you don't hear many modern accounts of anybody seeing a frogman.
Right.
anywhere right. else. That's what I was just talking about before the show too. Is like, yeah, I love the Loveland Frogman. I love the story, or you know, the kind of like mythos about it. But I don't know.
Yep.
You know how rooted in lore it is, and how rooted in possible reality of a cryptid. But again, that's sure. why it's a cryptid.
Exactly.
But it was fun. It was a lot of fun. I love the stories. He killed it too, Tobias.
Yeah, Tobias from Singular Fortean is his it. Group. But Tobias has been featured in Small Town Monsters documentaries. He's mm-hmm. been on some of the Josh Gates TV shows.
Okay.
Expedition Unknown.
Okay.
So he's been featured on different documentaries. Is a researcher.
Yeah.
Fortean researcher
yeah.
is kind of his specialty. But his whole presentation on the Lake Michigan Mothman.
He came in strong.
I hadn't like known great. Much about that story at right. all. So amazing to hear more about that.
Yeah, he kind of kicked the door down on that one. That was great.
Yep. Great stuff by Tobias. Got to chat with him a little bit before and after, and he's got a lot of cool things happening.
Oh, yeah.
But Singular Fortean on Instagram. And this is B. Mills. B. Mills was awesome. I mean, she shared some great personal stories and
right.
Vocalizations, different evidence, but had an awesome presentation. And, you know, she's... we had found out later. She came and hung out when
yeah.
we went and hung out with Cryptids of the Corn and
had some dinner and Joel, afterwards.
Yeah. So she let me know that she's the producer of the Bigfoot, the Hocking Hills Bigfoot Festival. So that
need
was
to go to that.
Put two and two together there. And yeah. I know Justin spoke really highly of her. So it was cool to check B out with this presentation.
It was great to see her presentation overall and just get to talk to her as well, because she's yeah. no different from the presentation to her. You know, she's a very seamless, right. doesn't put on anything. It's not about, and no. not that anybody did, but just the overall delivery of each
we've
different
We've been to a
topic.
Lot of conferences and have yeah, seen the gamut of personalities.
Right, right. And she was much more like kind of like, almost seemed like very enthused, but yeah, nonchalant too at the same time of like very
oh, yeah.
easygoing about her research and very yep. fluid about yeah, you know, if you have questions or reaching out, like from what you had said, it seems yeah. like she's just, and from what I gathered and interacted with her, I
so, thought she was a great person. Cryptids of the Corn says she runs both the festival and the conference.
Oh, cool.
So, yeah, she did mention the conference as well.
Cool.
The Hocking Hills Bigfoot Festival and conference. Make sure you guys go check that out.
Put that on the radar.
I know we will be. And then Jeff, of course, Jeff Craig.
Yeah.
He's the kind of brainchild behind the Frogman
the
Fest. It
yeah.
was, you know, really well ran. I think a lot of people were happy. It went really smooth.
They kept bringing extra chairs in all day.
Yeah.
It was
yeah,
great.
Very focused
yeah.
and conscious about, you know, the speaker room and making mm-hmm. sure everybody had seats. Jeff, those guys nailed it.
Did a great
Thank
job.
Thank everybody at Frogman Festival. All the people behind the scenes. It was
Ashers,
just a good time. Yeah, Ashers. Mm-hmm.
Did a wonderful job. I love the frog eyeballs that people were wearing. There were quite a few people
right.
dressed in full regalia.
Oh, yeah.
As a full frog man.
Yeah.
Jeff had a frog painted on his face at one point. I mean, it's,
yeah.
again, like, you know, if I grew up around that area, and that was probably, I'd probably be even more into it. I'm already into it because I like that
yeah.
avenue, right? I like
yeah.
cryptids, and I like. Now that we've gone to a couple of these conferences,
yep.
yeah, I love going because you're in a like-minded environment to where, you know, generally you're not in a like-minded environment when you're talking about cryptids or paranormal or whatever
oh, yeah.
it is. So
you're definitely
to find your tribe, so to speak,
you.
In that
yeah.
in that genre is great because you go, hey, is it weird that I saw this? Or is it weird that I, you know, want to see a frogman or whatever it is? Like, it's cool to have
it
that.
It is weird, but in a great way.
That's when you get excited about the weirdness. That's what I'm saying. It's great.
Yep.
It's palpable.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they had that's the other thing that I thought about the festival was great. You could feel that energy all day. Like, it didn't stop.
Yeah.
It just trucked on through the day, knocked it out in one afternoon, you know, one
yeah,
day.
Yeah, and being a one-day festival, I think, was
very
perfect
clean.
For the first year. I think
yeah.
they nailed it, being able to kind of pack everything in that 10 a.m. to really 5 p.m.
Well, I think the MetaZoo... And gameplay
yeah, shout out
outlasted,
to MetaZoo.
Outlasted
it,
the festival.
We left, yeah. It was still going on. Shout out to MetaZoo. They sponsored
And anybody that does the
sponsors.
MetaZoo gameplay, I had a question. I didn't want to interrupt anybody. What's the goggles about?
I learned a lot more.
I saw everybody
about
wearing goggles.
Yeah.
I want to know about that. Any game that you need goggles to play, I'm probably in on. That's what I'm saying.
Termenic, you got to hit him up on Instagram. He's one of the big players in in the MetaZoo game. But he actually set up his camera and microphone next to us.
The first
during
one.
D's D. Elliott.
Yeah.
Great.
That was a great presentation.
Yeah. Folklore of the Big Three of West Virginia.
If I would have known that was a Mothman degree, I probably would have done
that.
That's what we're doing now. Without a degree. I'm sorry. I don't mean to say that we do not have the degree. What I'm saying is, had I known that was a possibility.
D. Elliott has a degree. And
it's a great way to get started.
Folklore wrote a dissertation, which was their presentation. From the
thesis.
Their thesis. Yeah. Really cool to see them.
It's a good job.
Doing such good work, you know.
We got to shout out some people in there quick. Justin Lamb.
Yeah, what's up, Necro. Justin Lamb?
Necro's already got the frog up in the chat.
Yep, I love it. Love it. canoeing down in that's something that like Loveland.
Great.
The whole town is, all those people are canoers and kayakers and there's so much cool stuff that down there you pull your boat up and get out.
But see, that's what saved us growing up in the next spot. We had a little creek or a stream at least.
We always were in the creek.
We're in flat land, but
always in the creek.
You had somewhere that you could go see turtles, snakes, whatever.
Yeah.
We don't have that. So I think anytime I'm around water like that, I start to think about, because I don't have that necessarily visual distance nearby here. I can drive to it, but
yeah,
it's cool when you're just hanging out by it.
We could do some quick shout outs. Our Facebook group is growing. We've got some new members. I'd like to welcome R. Kelly Markle. Excuse me if I'm saying your name incorrectly. and Kane Barber. And then also we have Alex Samuel Thompson. Well, I think we might know that guy. Katie Nichols, Tyler Bond, Taylor Tigner, Omar De La Rosa Jr., Elvis Romero Fuentes. I think we know who that is. Kevin Clayton, Jeffrey Wilson. Hey, Jeffrey. Rich Koss, Anisha. I wonder who that is. Cody Stoner. Shout out to Stoner's little bro, Cody, and Felicia Baker. I think I know who that is as well.
Mm-hmm.
So welcome to all of them. And Bub, you got some shout outs from. You had a somewhat of a comment last week.
I made a comment. I made a comment that, you know, we look at our numbers and we check to, we don't check it, but it's just fun. It's like
who's listening where.
Yeah, because I'll look at this map and every day, like it could be something different. Like today, we had pop up Nigeria and South Africa. Never seen that pop up before.
Yeah,
Uzbekistan.
Hey,
who knows?
Welcome, Uzbekistan.
But I made the comment that who knows if people are actually listening in these countries or if it's a VPN. And I wasn't saying it to be a jerk. I said it in the same way. I said it. I support it either way, whether you're in Uzbekistan listening or you're in South Carolina listening, saying you're in Uzbekistan. I don't care.
Yeah.
As long as you're listening, that's cool. But then we actually had somebody reach out on social media and say, hey, that is me in Japan.
Yeah.
So we really appreciate
on
that.
Instagram,
that's,
shout out
that's
to
that's really cool.
Lindsay, right?
Lindsay Ann. Yeah.
Welcome from Japan. Thank you for listening to our show.
That's
and
cool.
She did mention she got hip to us through Hollow Sky and the
Holocaust. Right.
So
shout out to them.
She's always looking for good English speaking podcasts and
living abroad that.
Shout out to the Hollow Cult.
Yeah, big shout out. That helped. You know, just expose our weirdness to other people as well. So.
Yep. And by the way, our episode with Joel Thomas landed today on all the audio platforms.
It did.
So, you know, all you guys that have been tuning into that episode, we appreciate that.
We hit some more weird, you know, milestones already.
Yeah, Appalachian Intelligence crushed.
Yeah.
Another great episode. And then, we appreciate all those listeners on you guys on YouTube.
Yeah.
And also on Spotify, Apple, Google, wherever you're listening as well.
We appreciate it.
Yep.
We really do.
Anything else there?
I don't think so.
Okay. You want to hop in?
Any other social media? Sure. Dive right in.
Let's dive in, bub.
All right. So I got to just preface by saying I've finally jumped on to watching Last of Us. And so when I saw this article, I was just like, oh my God, we got to go into this. So it comes from the New York Times saying that the whiskey fungus fed by Jack Daniels encrusts a Tennessee town. So the dark growth fed by alcohol vapors from barrels of aging Jack Daniels whiskey has coated homes, cars, patio furniture, and road signs in a sooty crust, the residents are saying. So one woman is suing Lincoln County. And this article is by Michael Levinson. It's from March 1st of 2023. And so the ethanol-fueled fungus known as whiskey fungus has thrived for centuries around distilleries and bakeries. It's been the source of complaints from residents who live near Kentucky bourbon distilleries, Canadian whiskey makers, and Caribbean rum manufacturers. And they say now it is driving a wedge between some residents of Lincoln County, Tennessee, and Jack Daniels, the famed distillery founded in 1866 in neighboring Moore County. For months, some residents have complained that this sooty crust has blanketed their cars, their homes, basically anything outside that's going to get this kind of feeding of this alcohol fume that feeds this fungus. It's going to grow there. And so it just, you know, if it's landing on your house, that's where the fungus is going to grow on. So it's landing everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just crusting over everything. So Jack Daniels has built six warehouses known as bear houses to age whiskey in the rural county, which is home to about 35,000 residents and is building a seventh on a property that has room to house one more, a company spokesman said. The distillery has asked the county to rezone a second property where it could build six additional barrel houses. So you've already got residents with their houses turning into Stranger Things and looking like Last of Us. And, you know, I don't know if you could scrape that stuff off and ferment it yourself and brew your own Jack Daniels and just tell them, tough luck, make your own Jack Daniels out of it, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, what are you supposed to do? So if you're expanding your footprint of making this, what'd she say? Didn't they use the fungus find outlaws still in the woods? Oh, what does that mean? Oh, the outlaws stills in the woods are using. Oh, maybe.
Interesting. Never heard that.
No.
Or not to run. Good point.
A company representative, Don Willis, told county officials in November that 14 barrel houses would generate $1 million in annual property tax revenue for the county, which had approved about $15 million in general fund spending for the 2022 fiscal year. Not all the residents are happy about the expansion. Christy Long, the owner of a local mansion built in 1900, which she operates as a venue for wedding and other events, sued the county in January, contending that barrel houses near her property lacked the proper permits. Insider previously reported on the dispute. So there's some pictures there, too, of, you know, what it does to just the outside foliage, you know, your plant life. Not only is it covering a building, it's going to coat this other plant life and potentially, you know, suffocate out all of your flowers, trees, anything that looks nice. And it's that's wild. A judge ruled last week that one barrel house currently under construction had not been properly approved and that its building permit would have to be rescinded until Jack Daniels obtained the necessary permits. Mrs. Long's lawyer, Jason Holloman, said he planned to ask the judge and county to stop Jack Daniels from using other barrel houses near Mrs. Long's 4,000-square-foot mansion known as the Manor at Shea Joe. So I can see where this is coming now. You know, I'm not going to go into all of the article that deeply. It seems like there is now a point of they've been doing this for a long time. Jack Daniels is not doing anything different than what they've done historically. They're going to make a bigger property. What it seems like is there's value around that Jack Daniels, or there's value in the properties around them, and those property owners that are trying to do something with them can't do anything now because their property is basically suffering from all the fungal growth from this alcohol that feeds it in the vapors that come off the factory.
Right.
It's just wild.
Who
would have thought?
I mean, the fungus over time of that plant or distillery or whatever being there for so long that it's made its way into this special fungus.
Yeah, but they said it's common around like Caribbean rum houses and different. So it's not something unknown.
But just recently, it's just gotten out of control.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it sounds like A, not proper permits. Here's the thing I don't understand. How can't you just scrub that air so that you're not letting all, you know, it's a harmless byproduct, right? It's alcohol. what do you think? The birds are going to get drunk in the air, or somebody driving down the highway is going to inhale enough, you know, alcohol on the air particle and get drunk. No, so it's not a worry in that regard, but clearly it's doing something now that we see at a macro scale rather than if you're doing it for 5-10 years, it's probably not a problem, but you're doing this persistently to where you've now set up an ecosystem that feeds a problem. That's unheard of in my history of knowing how alcohol is made.
Don't buy a house next to a whiskey still is kind of all I'm getting here.
I wouldn't have thought that meant because of the fungus. I thought it meant you're
just going to get hammered all the time. Just get that wiki flowing 24. I mean,
you probably don't want to live next to the wiki factory if you like wiki.
Yeah,
100%. Not about the fungus.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I guess if you're
really speaking of wiki.
Yeah, I mean, what, you need a refill already?
No, I was just giving a nod to the wiki. Wiki. We're saying wiki now every time. Whiskey.
Goddamn. The next one, is that me? Are you good
next.
On this one?
You're next.
We hit all the points.
You got me laughing too much. You're good. Next. This is you and your you and your Goonies hunt for gold.
Well, you know, the Goonies had a massive impact on my life. So,
it's great.
You know, that was before. That's when you rented VHSs.
Or you borrowed them from a relative that had cable that dubbed them off.
Do you remember the little St. Henry grocery store that had the rental?
Gale's IGA?
No. It's no idea what it's called. But they're used. I don't think it's there anymore. But they had this little store, and they had a whole video rental department back there. And we would rent Goonies every weekend, 7 weeks in a row.
Was it attached to the grocery store? Because I just remember
it was on the back end of it. Yeah.
But it's right down the main drag of St. Henry.
Yes.
Yeah.
100%.
Brown front facade. I don't think it's like anymore. A car dealership now.
Yeah. Is that Gels?
I guess it would have been the back end of Gels.
Okay.
Yeah, which is now a restaurant.
Shout out to Charlie Gels.
There you go. 3G's restaurant.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a good spot.
7 weeks in a row. Why wouldn't you just buy me the VHS? Just get me the VHS. You're spending, I mean, economically. Now, again, I don't know if you knew this, but VHSs were like $100 buy back in the day. That's how Blockbuster and all these video rental companies became so big.
Sweet Jesus.
Because the people, you know, Hollywood's, the studios are in their head. If you have seven people sitting around watching
$100?
The movie, because Jesus. They think it is in terms of ticket prices. Well, you're going to have seven people over and you're all going to watch that all at once.
Well, that's how they controlled it.
That's $100.
That's how you control the... You got to make money off of
your mom and dad, my mom and dad, aren't going to buy a $100 movie for us to crack out on.
Ever.
The Goonies.
Ever. Nor should they.
Ten times.
That's absurd.
Kids now can just go on Netflix and watch their favorite movie. You want to watch...
You have no idea how hard it was, children that aren't watching this podcast. 200 times.
Yeah.
Or if there are kids watching this podcast, you have no idea.
No, what we had to go through. We had to drive all the way to St. Henry.
When I watched TV, whatever came on, I was happy with.
Yeah.
There was no, I wonder what's on or I want to watch that. It's like, good luck.
Exactly.
If Yanni, Live at the Acropolis, came on, guess what we were watching?
Yanni.
100%. Or we were watching the Moody Blues.
Yeah. Yeah.
God.
Well.
It wasn't bad. That was just would I pick it out? No.
Absolutely.
When we got satellite, we couldn't decide on a channel for more than 30 seconds.
Right. Well, you had 600.
We'd watch something. Oh, this is great. And kept flipping. I didn't watch a whole show for a year.
Yeah. But I grew up with HBO when I was a little kid. So I got to see a ton of movies.
Yeah. We got it junior high, high school.
And would just go nuts on, you know.
I got that in a pool table all in 1 year. It was great.
Yeah. No, your basement was really sweet.
It was a good hangout.
But anyways, back to what were we talking about? Oh, yeah. Articles. That's right. We're doing a news show. Okay, here we go. Fortune Magazine by Michael Rubinikin, the Associated Press, and headline, a metal detectorist is suing the FBI, claiming he alerted them to 7 tons of Civil War era gold, and they took it away in a secret overnight dig. Now, we've heard these kind of stories before.
7 tons?
I'm calling on you, yes.
7 tons.
7 tons. Again, we're not great at math. We always get into this kind of
paradigm. I know what 7 tons is. That's 14,000 pounds.
It's of treasure?
Of gold.
Of gold?
Like I said, Walter White got a barrel.
Okay, let's put this into perspective. They gave him money,
at least.
Yes,
they killed his brother-in-law, but they had to.
Well, they put Dean Norris in the hole. And
now, if this guy's brother-in-law dies and they don't give him 1 ounce of 7 tons of Civil War gold.
But we've heard this kind of thing plenty of times, you know, where these agencies, they come in. Anyways, we'll move on. Let's not speculate too far. Dennis Parada waged a legal battle to force the FBI to turn over records of its excavation in Dent's Run, Pennsylvania, where local lore says an 1863 shipment of Union gold disappeared on its way to the U.S. Mint in Philadelphia. The FBI, which went to Dent's Run after sophisticated testing, suggested tons of gold might be buried there, has long insisted the dig came up empty. So they are telling people that, yes, we did a dig there, but there's nothing there, nothing to see here. So Parada and his advisors, who have spent countless hours poring over the newly released government records, believed otherwise. They accused the FBI of distorting key evidence and improperly withholding records in an apparent effort to conceal the recovery of a historic, extremely valuable gold cache. The FBI defends its handling of the materials. Parada's dispute with the FBI is playing out in federal court, where a judge overseeing the case must decide whether the FBI will have to release its operational plan for the gold dig and other records it wants to keep secret. What? Okay, sounds like JFK file situation. The judge could also order the FBI to keep looking for additional materials to turn over to the treasure hunter. We feel, in quotes, we feel we were double-crossed and lied to, Parada said in an interview at his cramped wood-paneled office, where huge drill bits and high-end metal detectors compete for space with rusty miner picks, Civil War-era cannon parts, and other odds and ends he dug up over the years. This guy's legit. You walk into his office, you see drill bits, metal detectors.
Oh, he's living it.
You're in the right spot. Yeah. You want to go find some treasure?
He's not LARPing.
Parada, this guy, he's your guy.
Yeah.
Okay? Quote, the truth.
Like a honey badger.
Oh, yeah. He's obsessed. And guys like this, are they being tracked? Are these people being, you know, like National Treasure? A great movie, Disney movie.
Oh, yeah.
Nick Cage, you know, there's a new series out that's kind of like the new next generation treasure hunters of that series.
Okay.
But my kids like it.
Great.
So, you know, are these kind of guys being tracked almost to where, you know, something gets, hey, we're looking into this, they can just come in.
Now you're just saying the plot of Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark when he got the first.
They're ahead of you. They know what you're doing.
They let you do all the hard work.
Yep.
It's like the patent office.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead and file that patent, then make that thing. Then sue you.
Yeah.
They'll wait on you.
And then the lawyers come in, and then next thing you know,
well, not a honeypot.
They own it, you know.
It's just a trap.
Yep, exactly. And, you know, the FBI's got massive amounts of lawyers and people that are writing this stuff up.
What are they going to do with 7 tons of gold?
Melt it down and make coins. I don't know. What do you do with it?
Pay off some of our debt that we got going on, maybe.
Right.
Would be a good idea.
Why would
finding
they do that?
Cash. Can I just say one thing, too? Do you know this sounds like, was it the plot of City Slickers 2? The Legend?
No. Okay, continue. Sorry. That took me off guard. Very unique reference there,
Bob. Too much. Oh, God. That's what the movie's about, though. Curly's brother Duke comes back.
Yeah.
Because in Curly's hat, he had this map, like the other half of a map. But it was like somebody either robbed a train or like Civil War era gold that was like hidden in these mountains and these canyons. That's what I'm saying. Like when I hear this, that's what my brain does. I've heard this in a certain way, and I know there's a story out there. It's exactly, well, not exactly, but very close to it. And there's also the guy, wasn't there a guy who made his own treasure map? Or there's what's that area in like the Southwest where people go into those like canyons or back off into the cliffs and they don't make it back out? Everybody goes there looking for that gold. I can't remember the name of it. The Dutch miner.
Yeah.
Lost Dutch miner's gold.
Lost Dutchman's gold.
Yeah.
Yep, absolutely.
It's like stuff like that. I think
that's Arizona, like the Four Corners region. Yeah.
But there's also like this eccentric, I don't know if he was a millionaire or a billionaire, he made his own treasure map and literally made his own, like if you go find it and get it, I think somebody found it for sure.
Yeah.
I don't know how many millions or whatever it was in it, but sorry.
No. God, this is good. So in quote, he says, "The truth will come out," said Parada, co-founder of the treasure hunting outfits Finders Keepers. "Solving the mystery is not only his goal, finding the mystery is not his only goal. There he had hoped to earn a finder's fee from the potential recovery of hundreds of millions of dollars worth of gold." An FBI spokesperson declined to answer questions about the agency's gold dig records or respond to the cover-up allegations.
Of course.
Citing the ongoing litigation, last year the FBI released a statement publicly acknowledging for the first time that it had been looking for gold in Dent's run. The statement said the FBI did not find any, adding the agency, quote, "continues to unequivocally reject any claims or speculation to the contrary." They're digging in. So there is little evidence in the historical records to suggest that an Army detachment lost a gold shipment in the Pennsylvania wilderness, possibly the result of an ambush by Confederate sympathizers. But the legend has inspired generations of treasure hunters, Parada being among them. He and his son spent years looking for the fabled gold of Dent's Run, eventually guiding the FBI to a remote woodland site 135 miles northeast of Pittsburgh, where they say their instruments identified a large quantity of metal. The FBI brought in a geophysical consulting firm whose sensitive equipment detected a 7 to 9 ton mass suggestive of gold. Armed with a warrant, a team of FBI agents came in March 2018 to dig up the hillside.
Good gravy.
An FBI videographer was on hand to document it, at one point interviewing a Philadelphia-based agent on the FBI's art crime team who explained by the FBI was in the woods of one of Pennsylvania's most sparsely populated counties. "We've identified through our investigation a site that we believe has U.S. property, which includes a significant sum of base metal, which is valuable, particularly gold, maybe silver," the agent said on the video, his face blurred by the FBI to protect his privacy, calling it a 155-year-old case. Now, hold on a second.
What?
If you're in the FBI, are you able to protect their privacy? If there's somebody that's involved
in... Protect whose privacy?
This FBI agent. The video's blurred. I mean, are they... You know, you want to go back and figure out who this agent is.
Do they have, like,
is it
the
right
ability to obfuscate themselves? Or
I mean, what if you want to go figure some of this stuff out? What happened to this gold? You got to go interview and find this FBI agent.
That's why you don't tell them.
And you just take the go ahead. If you don't go ahead, you'll never get ahead.
You might as well just go ahead.
You have to.
If I found
one step beyond that,
look,
they're coming in and taking your. You know what?
What did you think was going to happen? You think they're going to go, "Hey, good job. You get to keep 7 to 9 tons of gold." No. And this is what I said a couple episodes about.
No, holesies.
I mean, you can tax it, but you can't take it.
I mean, how?
I guess you get taxed on that. You got to get taxed somehow.
Whole life looking
can't get
for
9 tons of gold and then not get taxed.
And the equipment, I mean, they have it all documented that, hey, we got this hit. There's massive amounts of metal.
Oh, they know it's
in this hillside.
They just thought they could push this guy away, is what it sounds like.
So it goes on to say, so where was I? Only a dig.
Oh, there you go. Born not to run. Touche. It's government property if it came off a train.
Right.
Therein lies the rub, too, though. What if it's proven that it came from this and maybe he doesn't have a claim to it necessarily? You would still think they'd give him, like, a, hey, finder's fee. Somebody returns your wallet to him, you know.
Sure.
Not that you expect it, but in 9 tons of gold, I'd kind of expect you to give me a couple shillings.
Well, they would have to document that, and that would tie him to the whole story. You know what I mean? Like, it leaves a paper trail. If they if they give him something somewhere along the line, that's got to be in a public record. So then this guy's in the public record of this treasure existing. And then all of a sudden they have to explain, hey, what happened to the 7 tons of gold and silver?
This is just like the worst twist of fate of, like, you're the treasure hunter who finds this massive cache of gold. Like, you're like, this is the storybook ending.
Taking pictures.
And then it's like, nope, exactly. We're going to just, you know.
Well, I wonder if they did document it and take pictures, and it's.
Oh, it sounds like that's what, from what you were saying, they're pushing for the judge to release that information. The FBI doesn't want to.
Yeah, exactly. So Parada obtained the video and other FBI records through a Freedom of Information Act lawsuit, hoping they would help answer lingering questions about what took place at Dent's Run 5 years ago. Parada was mostly kept away from the dig. From the dig site while the FBI did its work. Hmm. He suspects the agency conducted clandestine overnight digs between the first and second days of the court-authorized excavation, found the gold, and spirited it away. Residents have previously told of hearings and hearing a backhoe and a jackhammer overnight when the dig was supposed to have been paused, and seeing a convoy of the FBI vehicles, including large armored trucks. The FBI had denied it was conducting this overnight dig, clearly. Sure. Deny. Sure. Parada and a consultant, Warren Gettler, have focused a handful of FBI photos and accompanying photo log that have them questioning the FBI's official gold dig timeline. At issue is the presence or absence of snow in the images and the timing of the storm that briefly disrupted operations. For example, an FBI image that was supposed to have been taken about an hour after the squall does not show any snow on a large moss-covered boulder at the dig site. The same boulder is snow-covered in a photo that the FBI records indicate was taken the next morning, some 15 hours after the storm.
Sounds like they found a lot of gold.
Oh, sounds like somebody has
taken
that gold to the lower regions of the Smithsonian. Went full Jay,
gold member.
Jay, if you're listening, get us in. We'll take a look.
Soft disclosure for Jay.
Yep. So a photo op of them thinking, yes, exactly. He should have just ate it all the, like Cartman did.
I read that in Man Bear Pig.
Oh, exactly.
Oh, my goodness.
Like Cartman did in the Man Bear Pig South Park episode. Exactly.
It's a good show.
Well, yeah, it goes on, but you get the gist of it.
The gist of it is he's getting the runaround.
Yeah.
And he, again, should have just taken the go-ahead route and put 9 tons of gold in his piggy bank.
Right.
How do you spend that?
Well, you melt it down and you make it into currency.
You think?
And you distribute it to, you know, whatever.
Somebody asks you where you got this gold. A lot of things. Where'd you get this gold? You keep going. And
it's our reserve.
You'd have to be like Annie Dufresne across the country. 9 tons?
Yeah.
Overnight, you became like, again, the Walter White of gold. You have 9 tons of gold.
Well, the government can hide things, big things.
They can. I'm saying a person, like if I found 9 tons of gold, what do I do with that? How do you spend it?
You hire
the government.
Now you're rich. You can hire a ton of people to dig it out and pull as much as you need out of it.
Mine. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Buy a gold mine.
Just dump all of it in there.
Buy an old gold mine. Yeah. Yep. Exactly. That's pretty good. Exactly.
Hey, that's pretty good. That's plausible. Okay. I like that. Just buy a gold mine. Hey, if Adam Aaron can do it for AMC just keep movie theaters,
getting then more gold.
Yeah. All right. Any other thoughts on the.
Nope. I think we got that.
Gotcha.
Just to that one.
Okay.
That was a good one.
Say you found it there. I love that. Next title headline. We've had a lot of the UAP headlines in the news, different countries, different states. They're all over the globe. We're shooting them down. It's a Hobby Lobby balloon, whatever it is. We don't even know still. I don't even want to really go down that. I just wanted to kind of introduce this. But, you know, there's kind of a great question in that, too, of, like, you're shooting $500,000 Sidewinder missiles or whatever they are at a balloon.
Yeah,
you don't know that when you're shooting it.
Yeah.
You got to know that.
Right.
I don't know. Anyhow, so next quote or article comes from TMZ, and it's not directly their own story. I mean, Steven Spielberg was doing a lot of this, but Steven Spielberg says there's life out there, and our government is hiding it from us. So from March 4th of this year. Steven Spielberg says U.S. government is hiding info about UFOs from you and everyone else in the country. The E.T. director was blunt on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. Quote, I think the secrecy that is shrouding all of these sightings and the lack of transparency until the Freedom of Information Act compels certain materials to be released publicly, I think that there is something going on that simply needs extraordinary due diligence. Amen. Kudos. That's probably a good way to say it, and it needs to have more eyes on it. He's clearly intrigued by all the sightings, including the Pentagon's conclusion that it cannot explain more than 100 UFOs. Quote, I think what has been coming out recently is fascinating, just absolutely fascinating. I would like to hear more about it. I don't know what they are, referring to the UAPs, UFOs. And we also have a video from this one. It just kind of surmises, he doesn't think they're being honest with us.
Yeah.
The thrilling conclusion of my conversation with a man I now feel comfortable calling Mr. Spielberg.
Let's talk about UFOs for a minute. What do you make of what's going on right now?
Oh, it's exciting. There's something out there.
You don't think a believer. He's known stuff.
I don't know if I'm a believer in the sense that I'm kind of the person that would think.
He's been in some pretty big rooms.
I got to see something like that to believe it. I can make up stuff.
Sure.
And make movies about things that I've never seen or experienced, and that's fine. But in terms of really believing something, I think I'd have to have my own close encounter. Mm-hmm. I've never seen a UFO.
Nothing that's unexplained.
I've never seen anything that I couldn't explain. Mm-hmm. But I believe certain people who have seen things that they can't explain that is unexplainable. I think what has been coming out recently is fascinating. Just absolutely fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the secrecy that is shrouding all of these sightings and the lack of transparency and the Freedom of Information Act compels certain materials to be released publicly, I think that there is something going on that simply needs extraordinary
Man, they're giving Hollywood the go-ahead to start going
full bore. I would like to hear more about it. I don't know what they are.
Floodgates.
Imagination and my love
like Hollywood.
I don't believe we're alone in the universe.
Speaking for Hollywood here.
Well, I think it's mathematical.
So you got some provocation because of the UAP sightings recently. It's obviously driving the conversation, right? If we didn't have all these UAPs that were being shot down, he probably wouldn't have the segment. He wouldn't just randomly ask Steven Spielberg, what do you think is the government hiding UFOs? But what the UAP, we shot down these balloons or whatever they were, what that did is it at least started the conversation in public.
Yeah,
not just here on The Strange Road or whatever podcast talks about
and
UFOs.
Stephen Colbert does not get into this territory.
No,
you know what I mean? Like,
no,
it's weird. It's almost like all the mainstream narratives are just, hey, run with whatever you want. Whereas so much in the past, it's been just controlled.
That's where we're
going to
see aliens first.
You're not
going
to see Stephen Colbert doing a giant interview with Steven Spielberg, dude. Like, that's TV and Hollywood levels, top levels of Hollywood here. And it's just all open.
They hit the
play button.
No
big deal.
They took the go-ahead route.
Man.
Went right on ahead with disclosure.
My conspiracy mind is just going, to this.
Wait till you get to the next article that you're going to read.
It's just,
I'm going to put it even crazier there.
So were you good on that one?
Yeah, I mean,
the video kind of says it all here.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of my take on it. Maybe he's thought this for a while. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. He's not in on it. He doesn't know about UFOs. We'll give him two sides of this coin, obviously, but he could also have the Kubrick side of fake the moon landing type thing. You got Spielberg making E.T., Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Yeah.
The guy that says he doesn't have any of these experiences, I believe you.
Yeah.
But you're also making some of the most
iconic paranormal, extraterrestrial.
Dude, we stay at a Devil's Tower
in
Wyoming. They play that movie every night at 7.
Every night.
Every night.
That's amazing.
And the tower's right there behind the
That's so
theater
cool.
screen. It's awesome.
That's so cool. E.T., shout out to you.
Shout out to E.T.
You know, copyright infringement at a B. He's a, you know, just our
He's our kind of our spirit
here.
Guide.
Yep. He's our buddy.
He actually has some clothes that
ever
was
since
fashioned by
2018 Bonnaroo, I think it was.
He's got a little utility belt on.
Which we're trying to have Ron on at some point. We'll have Ron on to help kind of tell the whole backstory of E.T. and Ron from the Parachute People. We're working on
Reshoot Ron.
Making that happen as an episode. But he's doing great work. So there you go. Look at that. He's got the wiki, the crystal skull. He's feeling good
about
life. Maybe
that's why people like the Strange Happenings. They're getting entranced with the glance into E.T.'s eyes and his just...
He's here. We gotta scoot him over.
He's like there the extraterrestrial Uncle Sam. I want you for the Strange Road. That would be a great poster if we could get Spielberg to sign off on that.
Where's your will to be weird? We want you.
Yeah, I want you to phone home.
Okay, here we go. Last article. Yes,
we got one more after this.
Okay,
so this
is from The Bite by Frank Landymore. Mm-hmm. Wu-Tang affiliate collaborates with NASA to release rap song about space. Okay, we got rapper Wu-Tang affiliate known as Kamran or Lazarus Khan is a big fan of NASA and space travel. And to profess his love for both, Lazarus says he will be premiering a brand new song called Pale Blue Dot from aboard the International Space Station later this month. The rapper announced in an Instagram live stream with former NASA chief scientist Jim Green.
How wild's that?
But Lazarus didn't just want to write your average space schmaltz single. Instead, he wanted to write something more realistic and grounded in science. And who better to consult than Green, who also offered up his expertise on Ridley Scott's film The Martian. I didn't want to do a song about space and just sound like, okay, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about,
right.
said the enthused Lazarus. But there's this philosophical introspective element Lazarus was trying to explore in his single too. There's different insights we can gain just from being out there in space. And looking in that can help our world and society, he said. Lazarus added that he viewed hip hop as an ideal genre to speak on topics like space travel, what's going on in outer space. And do we have a video on this one, was it? Or the last one?
I think we have a video on the last one.
Oh, okay. It's not this one. So there you go, man. Wu-Tang in space. That was crazy. Yeah, that was a quick one. Do you want to take the last one?
Mm-hmm. This one comes from Coast to Coast AM. Shout out to them and George Norrie because I love that show. Video is of venomous caterpillars that are invading Virginia. And I'm sure if you're a Virginian, you know these caterpillars. So wildlife officials in Virginia have issued a warning about hairy venomous caterpillars that produce a powerful and painful reaction when touched. According to the Virginia Department of Forestry, the deceptively diminutive creatures with the appropriately nightmarish name puss caterpillars have recently been spotted in several counties in the eastern part of the state. Somewhat resembling a tiny toupee, the fuzzy bug is far from adorable and, in fact, is one of the most venomous species of caterpillar in the United States by way of toxin, which is easily transferred from its fur.
Caterpillars so, get, yeah.
I didn't know this. I'm not like I touch a lot of caterpillars, but.
Somebody put a caterpillar during two-a-days in the back in football practice in the, like, pulled my pants back
and
dropped
really?
It. Dude, it hurts so bad. Like, my whole skin became so incredibly inflamed.
I'll bet.
And I didn't know till years later that caterpillars are extremely toxic. Our boy, Mr. E, probably knows a lot more about that.
Jeez, what'd you put on there? Some gold bond medicated? Or
just picked the little things out over time. And my it was wild. So these are, like, a whole other level.
Yeah.
Of, like...
Well, They've been cautioned. Toxic. Yeah, the residents have been cautioned that the insects can be found in parks or near structures. The department added, advised residents, if you find the caterpillar, leave it alone and let its natural enemies control their populations. There are a number of other insects that will prey on them at different stages of their life cycle. So should an unfortunate individual come into contact with one of these creatures, experts say they could suffer a variety of reactions, including an initial intense wave of pain followed by possible nausea, fever, vomiting, and muscle cramps. And here's a quote from somebody that actually had this experience. So it was like nothing I'd ever experienced, recalled puss caterpillar victim Julie Hammer to a local television station. It was excruciating. It did not let up at all. The experience was so intense that she wound up in the emergency room seeking treatment while it felt like I was being stung during the entirety of her hospital visit.
Yeah.
While experts are uncertain as to why the non-native insects have arrived in Virginia, given the strangeness that has been 2020, it's not altogether surprising. To that end, now we're left wondering what might happen if they tangled with a murder hornet.
I mean, they just, right.
Jeez, Pete.
Well, they just come in shipping containers and
that
stuff.
That is an ugly,
Costco, you know, and like weird a Costco looking. Order.
That, it does. It looks like a hairpiece. The picture at the bottom.
There we go. Here's the video. Insect that could be quite painful.
The toupee caterpillar.
We're talking about the pus caterpillar.
Oh, you
and they're starting
pus.
Their annual crawl across Virginia. These hairy brown critters look more like rodents than caterpillars. 10 on Your Side's Jason Marks first told you about them way back in 2013. A Virginia Beach woman
what do you
told
want me
us
to do?
She accidentally
Look
touched
at that.
One
See, that's
and kinda, quickly regretted it.
That's
the pus caterpillar
my,
is one of two poisonous caterpillars
looking.
Found in the area.
Oh.
When I picked up the cooler, I smashed the caterpillar against my wrist, and he stung me, and it happened right here. It was like nothing
Dang.
I've ever experienced.
Good, man.
It was excruciating.
You know what
it
reminds
did
me
not let up at all.
Getting stung
so
by a jellyfish.
The mm-hmm. whole time I was in the emergency room,
little
it felt like I was still
they have
being
in
stung.
Their tentacles
Both of them
sting
will have exactly the same reaction. They have these hollow spines that are filled with an acid-like material. It protects them from birds. That's
my wife got stung.
That's its benefit to the caterpillar.
Yeah. Norfolk, Virginia.
Wow. So far, they've been seen in Richmond, but not in Hampton Roads.
So
oh, yeah.
Like,
if you
having,
do
like,
get
fever
stung,
dreams on the way home, I was cruising through the mountains doing like you know, the speed limit.
Right.
And
she
was like looking out the sunroof of the car, just like literally hallucinating. I was like, it's okay. Just keep drinking water.
Yeah.
You know, just, I asked her, do you want me to pee on it, which is the way you neutralize the jellyfish thing, but I don't think it's proper recourse on the beach in the daytime.
No, and I kind of got yelled at on a...
You peed on someone?
No, it was in the introductory explanation of what happens if you get stung by a jellyfish, and of course I blurted out, shouldn't I just go pee on her? And the guy was like, no way. Don't do that. Just come up to the snorkel area and we'll take care of it. But please do not do that. Sorry.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
Gosh, damn.
I was in Mexico.
That's hilarious.
They all laughed.
I did too. Yeah, and I was mispronouncing the name of the caterpillar. It's a pus caterpillar. Puss. I said,
now we know. Now we know.
Apparently not right.
We
potato,
learn
potato.
Stuff every day on this show.
Yep, you know, well.
But look how gnarly that thing is.
It looks
it's
like.
It's so weird. I mean, if I came across that, I'm thinking that thing's not a caterpillar. That's some kind of a weird slug.
Looks like a chicken wing with fur. It's gross. It's giving
You know what it reminds me of? Those weird modular body things that were dancing around.
Oh, God.
The modular body,
no.
Creepy chicken dancing. I don't know what.
That was a grotesque episode.
Yeah.
I couldn't watch that video.
Necro made a body with Krang inside of him.
I said it looked like Pickle Rick. That's all I could think of when I was watching him connecting like chicken nuggets of meat together from cells that he grew from himself. He cultured those cells from himself. That's the even grosser, weirder part. There's something about if you've ever had a surgery. Where either, and I've had a lot of them, so I've had a plate put in my arm for the first time I went mountain biking with Mike.
First
and I
time ever.
Broke my arm and knocked myself out and chipped some teeth and
oh God, that was
split
horrible.
My chin to the bone. And so then I got a plate put in my arm, and that was interesting because, you know, when I was a nurse, I would always have the thought from like, you know, you can kind of like empathize with people, but if you don't know what a broken bone feels like, you just don't know.
Yeah.
So not that I want any more of them, but I have that experience. Or having like a piece of your body removed is a weird thing to wrap your head around.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's strange because I had like part of my bone in my throat from when I face planted.
Yeah.
And then I had a.
You cracked your face on the bridge that was down good. On the bottom of the hill.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If that bridge wasn't there, you probably wouldn't have gotten near as hurt as what you did.
I don't think so.
Yeah. Well,
I don't know.
Lessons learned.
Don't do it
and
again.
And you've never gone mountain biking ever since then.
Sold it immediately
first
after.
First and only time.
First and last time mountain biking.
Oh, man.
I just realized I don't need new hobbies at this age. Well, at least not like deadly 15 ones.
15 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. And even at that age, it's like I'm good. I played guitar for a long time in my life, and I thought if I lose the ability to play guitar because I did this, I would have been really upset.
And by the way, we're going to get Bub to finally play guitar.
At some point.
Before an episode of Strange Happenings. We just got to get him a message out the day before to bring your guitar down here. We'll get the mic set up and we'll have a little jam session. Yeah. Why not? Strange Happenings is loose.
We can do what we want.
Do an intro.
Yeah.
That'd be fun. So anything else? I think that was it. You know, as always, you can find us at The Strange Road on all socials, including TikTok, by the way, everyone.
Brand new.
Just crushing it over on TikTok with now approaching 1,300 followers, I believe. So TikTok
Stoner's videos. TikTok account is like the Robin Williams movie when he was in like the fourth grade and he was 40. Like he blew past so many things in like days on TikTok. And I was like, how did you make this happen? Not mad about it. It's just like, man, TikTok is like on another level of engagement. So.
Yep. Yep,
he has been crushing it, so it's awesome.
Oh, and by the way, Born Not to Run, the intro music is our buddy Legend and Bub's original music.
Yeah.
So
we make all the music.
The outro music, the intro music right now is formerly Bright Night Alaska was the group, but you guys are kind of evolving into...
We're looking for a new name. We don't really have a band. We just make music for the fun of it.
Yeah.
If you want to listen to stuff and you want to dig up on us, yeah, we did have a band named Bright Night Alaska, and we did 12 songs and made some EPs. But yeah, appreciate that. Yeah, making music for the intro and outro is always something that we're working on. And just have fun. It's fun to have something to lead, you know, audience into. Fill
that
space.
It's a banger, dude.
Yeah.
That track,
the song's great.
The track will roll out for you guys after this.
That's Legend.
A Legend original. That's our buddy. He's made music for us in several different occasions. But,
yeah. He knows his stuff.
But Facebook group, Strange Road Hitchhikers, check us out there.
Yep.
Bub's on Twitter, handles all of our
Twitter
stuff. I'm usually on the Instagram side of things. Stoner's the TikTok man. And of course, we always want to thank the Wizard Stoner.
Absolutely.
And Sir Bro of Diz. Those guys are great looking.
Couldn't do it without them.
Everything sounding good. Looking good.
Fantastic.
Couldn't ask for better two dudes to be helping us with all that.
The only thing I ask more of is myself to help them do it easier. Try to get in my seat. Try to get ready. It's hard for me.
Getting Bub in the seat.
It's like corralling a herd of turtles.
Since the first episode ever.
It's difficult.
Has been difficult. But over the years, I've learned how to be the puppeteer of the Bub's.
He helps direct me.
From time to time.
Yeah.
All the, you know, Instagram, you can find us. You guys know where we are.
Yeah.
Listen. Follow.
Tell your friends, tell your family, tell anybody that you think
that
they might like to listen to this. Like Necro just said in the chat, hit the like button.
You know. Thank you.
Not trying to be overly needy or asking, but anything that you can do to help us kind of keep doing this. That's why we're here, and that's hopefully what we're doing. But we appreciate it, and just kind of put the message out there, you know, put the bug in people's ears. I'm doing it.
Question.
I'm doing it now all the time. I told my dentist today when I had to go to the dentist. I was like, you know what we're doing? She's checking it out. I told the barber the other day.
Oh, yeah.
I tell everybody about this.
Yeah,
so,
for sure.
I like doing it. I want to keep doing it.
Just a quick question.
What's up?
How did Rolo's bed get all the way over there?
I put it over there.
You put it all the way over there? He moves his bed from time to time.
Oh, he moves his bed.
Yeah.
You know we're done?
Yeah, he does. He knows when the outro is so funny, dude. He knows when the outro is happening. Oh, bozo.
He's a good baby.
All right. So, yes, thank you, Necro. Hit that like button and everybody else. You know, review the show on Apple and Spotify if you guys like the show. But that's it for us.
Give us suggestions. Yeah. Tell us what you're watching, listening to, what you read, whatever it is.
The Strange Road Hitchhikers group on Facebook. Drop links in there. Drop anything that you think is cool. Who knows? It might end up on
the
show.
Hit up that Facebook group, too, because yeah. that...
And some of you guys I know aren't on Facebook, which we're working towards a Discord channel.
But
some
now
other
you have
things.
A community of somewhere that people can go and kind of congregate is what I was trying to get at, yeah. more or less, because I don't use Facebook either. But if you have it, spaces are being set up so that people can kind of, you know, keep
Come
these conversations
out.
Going. Yeah.
Yep. Stoke the fire. Thank you to all of you in the chat. You guys are the best. And we're signing out. Drop that... tune, bro.
See you guys. Amazing.